Hello and welcome to the podcast, An Intelligent Look at Terrorism. I'm your host, Phil Gurski, President and CEO of Borealis Threat Risk Consulting in Ottawa, Canada. And we are taping here on the 3rd of April, 2020. So yes, still very much in the COVID-19 crisis. And yet there are other issues out there that don't have to do with COVID. I'm sure that all of us are a little bit tired of reading about COVID and what to do and what not to do. And people are very afraid as to what's happening down the road. So I thought I would switch things up a little bit. And I'm very, very pleased to have with me on my podcast today, Bruce Hoffman. If you don't know who Bruce Hoffman is, then you know nothing about terrorism studies in the modern world. Bruce has been around forever. It's nice to meet somebody who's been around longer than I have. Bruce has been doing this for over four decades. He's currently at Georgia University's Walsh School of Foreign Service. He's been with the RAND Center. He's written book after book after book. In fact, his third edition of Inside Terrorism was cited as one of the 25 most notable books published by Columbia University Press. So Bruce, thank you and welcome to the podcast.
Thank you, Phil. I'm delighted to be with you.
So let's start with a really easy question. You're like me. You've been around since, you know, the dinosaurs roamed the earth. You've been looking at terrorism for a long time. Can you give my listeners a sense as to what terrorism studies were like way back in the late 70s, early 80s, before the whole post 9/11 period happened? What was the top, sort of top of your mind, and where was the field going back then?
I think that probably the best encapsulation of where the field was then is that the really good scholarly authoritative books on terrorism probably took up about, you know, one shelf of a bookcase, if at most. It was a very small field. Of course, it had developed in the early and mid-1970s in reaction to a lot of the far more journalistic accounts that were emerging that in some cases were excellent, but in other cases were somewhat overheated. And it was an attempt to provide some international, some intellectual rigor to the field. So there were a handful of founding fathers and mothers, as it were, who in many instances are still the leading figures in the field. Martha Crenshaw, formerly of Wesleyan University, now having retired yet again from Stanford University. Brian Jenkins, who still works,
of course,
at the RAND Corporation. The late Paul Wilkinson, of course, who passed away about 8 years ago, which was a tremendous loss. David Rappaport, who's still editing Terrorism and Political Violence, the first scholarly journal.
He's a great hero of mine, David. I had the pleasure of meeting him in Colorado Springs a few years ago, and I was awestruck at meeting David. I'm a big fan of his work, and it was like meeting, you know, the one guy that you see as the hero in the terrorism field.
All right. Well, he and Walter LeCour, who would have been the last person I'd mentioned, just among others in that group. And Walter unfortunately passed away over a year ago. They used to argue with one another who actually taught the first class in the United States on terrorism and counterterrorism, and I've never been able to figure that out, but I'm sure, you know, both of them, whoever was first, it was in a very short period of time. And of course, back then, I mean, I maybe there were two, three, four universities that had courses on this subject. It really, you know, it really wasn't until, oddly enough, the 1990s that terrorism began to take hold of much, much more solid academic base, where you started to have universities begin to offer courses and even degrees on the subject. And the reason I say oddly is because one of the reasons I left the RAND Corporation in 1994 and went to St. Andrews University in Scotland to work with Paul Wilkinson and co-found the Center for the Study of Terrorism and Political Violence, which just celebrated its 25th anniversary earlier this academic year, was because with the end of the Cold War, the argument at the time is that terrorism was over, that, you know, this was the time of the New World Order where peace and democracy would prevail, when the internet would be only an engine for truth and for education and for edification. And the assumption was that, especially with the demise of the Soviet Union, even though the same people who a decade earlier had said the Soviet Union was not behind all the world's terrorism, a decade later, then with the collapse of communism in the Soviet Union, the argument shifted. But there wasn't much interest, at least governmental interest, for a time in terrorism. And yet in Scotland, of course, only 6 years before, there had been one of the most tragic incidents of that era, the in-flight bombing of Pan Am 103 in December 1988. And Paul had this vision of setting up a terrorism center. And he was finding, one reason he recruited me to St. Andrews is more and more students were specifically coming to St. Andrews because they wanted to study terrorism and counterterrorism. And that was very much our vision in founding the center and in launching the study of terrorism. Of course, after 9/11, there was this tremendous proliferation, all to the good in the sense that, you know, there are literally now thousands of books on terrorism, and many of them have made signal contributions to the literature. But from what was in the old days, you know, about a shelf full of books is now, you know, basically an entire library, really.
No, you're right. And I remember seeing a statistic years ago, probably somewhere in the 2010s, maybe early 2010s, where in the post 9/11 period alone, someone had estimated 10,000 manuscripts had been written on terrorism. And you're absolutely right. What was very much a niche field has become a very sort of mainstream field. And I find the interesting part about terrorism studies, and this is a good thing, is that there's so many different disciplines are contributing to it. You have anthropologists, you have religious scholars, you have political scientists, you have international relations people, sociologists, psychologists. It's become sort of this gathering ground, if you will, of a bunch of people from different fields, all adding their own contributions to our better understanding of terrorism. So would you see, do you see that as a very much an advantage to this, what has become a very major field of international study?
Yes, certainly in the 1970s and the 1980s, as it is today, it was overwhelmingly dominated by political scientists. But then you would find a handful at best of psychologists or of perhaps historians, some people specializing in the law. But you didn't find the proliferation that we have today, just as you described, of anthropologists, criminologists like Gary LaFree, for example, who set up the START Center at the University of Maryland, that have contributed, I think, to the statisticians, for example, as well, very important. But that all these different disciplines, I think, have strengthened the field by bringing a number of different perspectives and also encouraging multidisciplinary or interdisciplinary research to an extent that it existed at places like RAND, at think tanks, before, let's say, the 9/11 attacks. But since then, that sort of collaboration has become much more common.
One criticism that's been leveled, including by myself on occasion, about some of these interdisciplinary studies is that it's all well and good to have them, but a lot of them have a paucity of data. There really are low data numbers that are being used to feed or to test these theories. Do you think that situation is getting better? Are academics getting better at collecting data, analyzing data, using their disciplinary tools to understand it? Are we getting to a place where, you know, they always used to say that intelligence services like where I worked had all the data, none of the knowledge, and you guys had all the knowledge, none of the data. Are things getting better?
Yes, I think there are, because there's so many different perspectives, and there's frankly so many young people coming into the field that I think is constantly infusing it with a new vitality, with very different and much needed perspectives. That was part of the problem in the 70s, 80s, and 90s. It was a very closed field. There weren't that many graduate students doing MAs or PhDs specifically on terrorism. As I said, in the 1990s, that's when that began to grow, and it only accelerated in the early, and has continued throughout the 21st century. And that's been very important. There is more data. At the same time, though, I think that terrorism is a very unique field of study in that there's a nuance to it that one only acquires from, in addition to the familiarity of deep knowledge and research in the field, but that, in fact, one only acquires by having a very broad perspective, which is to say, being able to engage in, you know, broad comparisons of groups. And that I think is something that has in a sense in the 21st century, you have people specializing to a greater degree than ever in the past.
And is that a function just of the, as you said, the increased numbers, whereby the more numbers you have, the more you have the ability to narrowly focus on a particular aspect of terrorism? Whereas, as you said, back in the 70s, when you had sort of the grand masters such as yourself and Martha and all other people, you had to be all things to all people because there were only so many of you in the room. So these increased numbers have allowed for specialization in that respect?
Well, no, I think it's less than, no, I was making two separate arguments, but you're right to clarify that. No, I think there is more data, and that is a very good thing. I mean, that's one reason that Brian Jenkins started the RAND chronology of international terrorism, because there was so much anecdotal or so much episodic analysis, except for, I think, really the historians in some respects, that he wanted to at least establish a more solid and rigorous empirical data set that one could work from. And that's been built upon and is developed, and I think there's many different ones. There's the one that, I mean, START has carried on and expanded and improved upon what was the RAND chronology, and it's now the Global Terrorism Database. Mm-hmm. Of course, Robert Pape in the University of Chicago and their CPOST database. I mean, there are far more data sets, and that's all to the good. The point that I wanted to make is that where I think there's been a big change, which I'm not sure is necessarily being for the better, there may be more data. There certainly is more knowledge. My only point is that a lot of the knowledge in the 21st century, because of the overwhelming strategic implications of the Salafi jihadi global terrorist threat, became very narrow and specialized. So when I was hired at RAND, I mean, I remember one of the justifications that I saw for my hiring was that I was a utility player, that I came there with one area of specialization, and that was Middle Eastern terrorists, but that I was, especially I think because of my historical training, I was adaptable enough that I was working on Tamil Tigers, the Irish Republican Army, left-wing terrorist groups active in Europe, right-wing terrorist groups active in Europe and the United States. I mean, you really had to be someone who could make lots of comparisons. And this, I think, led to understanding that terrorism, you know, what we necessarily see day to day isn't always new. I mean, there's a long legacy, and that there's an historical continuity that I think one has to be aware of, that over the past decade or so, I think has eroded as people have become highly specialized and become very siloed. I mean, you can be a suicide terrorism specialist and focus exclusively, let's say, on Al-Qaeda or the Islamic State, and be completely unaware of how the Tamil Tigers, for example, were the foremost exponents of that particular tactic for over a quarter of a century. So that's my point about being able to compare different geographies, different historical epochs, different groups with different motivations to tease out the commonalities and also the aberrations.
Yeah, that's a great point. In fact, you could argue that the Tamil Tigers, in fact, invented suicide bombing in the early 80s. I mean, I'm not sure that they make that claim, but certainly they perfected the use of suicide bombings. In fact, took out several Indian heads of state in that regard. You talked about how, you know, it's necessary if you want to be a true student of terrorism, understand terrorism, you have to have a broad understanding of different types of terrorist movements. And you and I both know, Bruce, that, you know, we are in a post 9/11 period. It's all jihadi all the time. For obvious reasons, you can't lose 3,000 people in one day and not focus on the number one threat, which was from then Al-Qaeda, and then, of course, ISIS and all the other groups. One criticism that's been given to a lot of actors lately, and I'm talking security intelligence services, like where I used to work, law enforcement agencies, is that this focus on Al-Qaeda, ISIS, and Islamist extremism was wrong. And they point to, you guys missed the ball. You're too busy looking for jihadis, and you forgot about the far right. You forgot about the neo-Nazis and the white supremacists and the white nationalists. And they'll point to all these attacks in Western Europe. You've had them in your country, New Zealand, Australia, Canada, etc. Is that a fair criticism, you think, to put on organizations such as those? Did they really drop the ball in not looking at the far right enough?
No, I don't think so. You know, terrorism is terrorism, and security and intelligence services, as well as law enforcement, I don't think ever made any of those distinctions when there were terrorist incidents. But that's the key. And in many countries, especially Western liberal democratic states, it's very difficult for intelligence and security agencies, much less law enforcement, to focus on emergent threats that have not crossed that threshold into violence. And that, I would say, is more of the issue. I mean, I worked in the FBI for 15 months when I was a commissioner appointed by the U.S. Congress on the 9/11 Review Commission. And I never saw any evidence there that any distinction was made between any kind of terrorism. I mean, terrorism was a criminal offense. I think what is, and of course one has to say too that the Salafi jihadi threat really was a global and presented, as we saw on 9/11, and when you had an Islamic State that was controlling territory with millions of inhabitants the size of England and Wales, I mean, a very different and much more challenging phenomena. I think it's always the case is that once there's an uptick or an upsurge in actual violent incidents, then the intelligence and security and law enforcement communities pivot and pay more attention to a threat that has now manifested itself and has crossed that line, has passed that threshold of committing violence. And I think there has very much been that shift. That's in the, you know, in my view, it's not an intelligence or law enforcement issue as much as the attention of political leaders and the prioritization that our elected officials put on these issues. And that's what still, I think, has to catch up, because we've been so overwhelmed with, let's say, international terrorist threats that it crowded out the domestic ones.
It's a really good point. Not surprisingly, I agree with you. Terrorism is terrorism. And it's funny, people can be critical of law enforcement, security, intelligence for not looking at it. And yet if we look at it when we don't have reasonable grounds to do so, we're accused of overreach. We're accused of making something a crime, which is not. And obviously in your country, much more so in mine, with the First and, you know, First, Second Amendment, things like that, that, you know, these freedoms are very closely held. And unless the law enforcement has reasonable grounds to believe you're going to actually engage in an act of violence, you could pretty well say and do anything you'd like. So I find it kind of disingenuous that people are saying, well, you know, why didn't you stop the attack on a mosque in Quebec City? And why didn't you stop the bombing at a synagogue in Pittsburgh? And why didn't you stop this? Well, there are rules in place, and there are rules in place for a reason. And thank God we have them. So moving forward now, you know, we're looking at almost 20 years after 9/11. Very rapidly, we're approaching the anniversary. People have written off Al-Qaeda before. People have written off ISIS before. And they're saying that these groups are no longer what they once were. And maybe we can sort of shift attention to that. I'm not asking you to be predictive. I don't think you have a crystal ball any more than I do. But how do you see where the focus should be moving forward over the next couple of years? Can we afford to shift significant resources away from the Salafi jihadi threat to this other, you know, far right, and I would include far left in there as well, single issue threat? Or is it we really need our agencies, and more importantly, or equally importantly, is our scholars to look at all of the above all the time simultaneously?
That's a very good question, because it gets to the heart of what the problem is that both our countries, and I would say that any countries that have been touched by terrorism over the past nearly two decades, there's just an immense feeling of enervation and of wanting to declare victory and to end these wars on terrorism and to end the overseas military commitments that they entail, and to be able to focus on other national security threats. And after all, a pandemic is as severe, perhaps even more severe, and certainly far more encompassing than terrorism. But I think it's not an either or choice, either with what national security threats we'll pay attention to and which we'll ignore. By the same token, which terrorist threats we'll pay attention to and which we ignore. I mean, that to me is the fundamental paradox, or so I shouldn't say that, the fundamental challenge of security in the 21st century is that you have to cover the waterfront and you have to pay attention to all these threats, because all of these threats impact society. And I think we have to understand that terrorism doesn't occur in a vacuum. It reflects the political divisions, it reflects the polarization, it reflects the contentiousness in societies, both domestic and also throughout the globe. And in that sense, we can't choose which to focus and which not to focus. But that's not to say, though, we shouldn't set priorities. And the priorities, of course, have to constantly be reviewed and re-reviewed in respect of what the main threats are and where the violence is originating. So I would say we have to pay attention to all these threats. It's just that we will have to focus on them at the same time, but with different levels of intensity that will constantly have to be adjusted, because none of these threats are linear.
are we getting to a point where people are just, they're tired? So, you know, you look back to the killing of bin Laden back in May of 2011. I'll never forget the scenes. I got a phone call from a friend of mine in the FBI saying, you know, turn on your TV now. And they're looking at the scenes outside the White House, the celebrations, you know, USA, USA. Similarly with the taking of al-Baghdadi, the fall of the fake caliphate, a lot of declarations of victory against these groups. And of course, the most recent decision by your government, a few years after my government, to essentially not withdraw completely, but pare down the forces in Afghanistan, which I would argue are actually feeding terrorism as much as fighting terrorism. Are people just getting fed up? And are they going to start putting pressure on governments to look at other problems? Now, that's not a fair question to ask today, because we're smack in the middle of COVID-19 and our countries are struggling to deal with it. But have people just had enough? As I said, we're approaching the 20th anniversary of 9/11. Do people just want to move on and just sort of make it all go away? Is there a sense of exhaustion because it's all terrorism all the time?
Oh, I mean, there's that same sense of exhaustion with the pandemic, especially after 3 weeks on, you know, being locked down. No, absolutely, people want to move on and go back to what they sense was the normality of some halcyon time that may have been less troubled, but nonetheless, of course, had its own challenges. But I think one of the lessons of the 21st century is you can't set back the clock. And what has happened has, you know, in the past, terrorism might have been an entirely localized phenomenon. But thanks to Al-Qaeda, thanks to ISIS, thanks to various other developments, and not least technological advances, such as social media, such as the platform that we're speaking on right now, the world has, in a very positive sense, become smaller. But at the same time, these challenges have now become global. And in my view, the distinction between domestic and international terrorism has almost completely eroded. Mm-hmm. Look at this lone wolf phenomena that mm-hmm. we've now been beset with for many years. It's the activation of people in place in their own countries who may never even have met the leaders or even the commanders of the terrorist group that they're carrying out attacks on behalf of. So in that sense, we may want to return, and I understand that. But I think we have to realize that, unfortunately, terrorism-like pandemics are just a fixture of 21st century security, the same way that, let's say, more conventional threats that we became accustomed to in the 20th century, interstate wars, for example, the prolongation over half a century of the Cold War, for instance. These are the new norms, and they're ones that we may want to run away from. They're ones that certainly we'd rather spend our, you know, national treasuries on other things. But it's these challenges that I think are going to dominate our security environment, certainly for decades to come. And terrorism, I think, has to be included in that. I'm not saying it should have a higher priority than other threats. But at the same time, what I am arguing is that we ignore it at our peril. We can't think that it's over, because as then General James Mattis famously said in 2013, the enemy always gets a vote. And in that sense, I think our enemies, no matter what ideological or religious stripe, see advantage in using terrorism and have voted to continue their struggles.
I liked your analogy with pandemics. You know, pandemics have been around since humans have been around, and they're going to be around until however long we'll remain as a species. And I think it's the same thing with terrorism. Like you said, it has evolved. And this is why I like David Rappaport's wave theory of terrorism. It's not perfect, but it really, I think, helped to encapsulate how major terrorism trends changed over the decades. And, you know, that goes back to what, the sort of latter half of the 19th century. We're now in the, you know, almost at the end of the first fifth of the 21st century. And like you say, that's still going on. Last question for you, Bruce, because I don't want to keep you too much longer, but how can we collectively, and by me, we, I mean, security intelligence service, law enforcement, academics, how can we work better together? I know that, you know, like I said, when I met you back at CSIS in 2009, we brought you up to do a lecture, you know, someone who is, you know, obviously a very well-respected scholar to lend his insight into terrorism. I know my own service has a very robust academic outreach program. How can we work to have all these parties working together so that we have the best practices in place to do the work that we need to do, so that at least from the pointy end of the stick, the security and law enforcement, we have the best knowledge available to stop bad things from happening and people from dying? Are there any insights or any suggestions in that regard?
One thing that is very obvious is Canada has had an exceptionally successful, I think, an open-minded approach to this. The Canadian Security and Intelligence Service has had a very robust academic outreach program now for well over a decade that I think pays dividends. I mean, the fruit of that relationship is always published and available to the general public, which is really a remarkably impressive thing and also a huge public service. But I would say that's almost completely unique in this field. And if anything, I think that the revelations of Edward Snowden of some years ago, who was a contractor, not an academic, but that in many countries poured water on this idea of more open exchange just because of the fears of what could be inadvertently released. So, you know, I see in the aftermath of 9/11, of the September 11th, 2001 attacks, of course, the 9/11 Commission had called for precisely this type of, you know, of open-mindedness and of greater engagement with academics and with other specialists in the field who may have been outside of government. And I would say that up until the killing of Osama bin Laden in 2011, that was very much the case. But at the same time, for some of the reasons I just described, in recent years, that has eroded more and more and constricted more and more. And I think what we're finding now, especially in the age of the internet and the availability of information, is that the open source information is just as valuable and important to cull through as the more classified sources of information that come from highly sensitive collection and sources. And that to function effectively in the 21st century, you have to be able to do both.
Oh, absolutely. I couldn't agree with you more. And speaking as somebody who spent 32 years in the security intelligence world, even when I started my career in signals intelligence way back in the early 80s, we were told not to use open source. We were told, we're not paying you to read the Globe Mail or the New York Times. We're paying you to do intelligence. And I would strike back, well, there's lots of good information out there. And one thing that, you know, when I moved to CSIS in 2001, that was very good, is that we had an incredible information, open source information center that would get us anything we wanted, whether it's books or articles or journals or whatever, to supplement what we're seeing on the classified side. So I agree with you wholeheartedly. There's a lot of information out there that has to be sort of, you know, wedded together and melded together to get a better idea of what's happening. And I do concur with you that, you know, with what Edward Snowden did, it maybe has cast a pall on a lot of security intelligence services being a little more risk averse in terms of bringing in outsiders. But thanks for the shout out to CSIS and the academic outreach, because that was an amazingly successful program that we ran and still run to bring people like yourself in. So I just want to thank you, Bruce, for your decades of dedication to helping us understand terrorism better. I want to thank you for being on the podcast today. And I get a sneaking suspicion you're kind of like me in that, you know, not planning on stopping talking about terrorism anytime soon. It seems to be more of a passion than a career, isn't it?
I've been studying it since 1976, which is a long time. So I think you can't, you know, and frankly, too, it's only gotten more challenging and I think more worrisome as well. So there's good reason to keep this focus on this subject. There's still a lot of work that needs to be done, and we shouldn't think that the threat is going away or that there's not going to be a need for a new generation of very intelligent, highly educated, and highly motivated both analysts and operatives.
You summed it up, Bruce. I couldn't put it any better. So listen, thank you very, very much for being part of the podcast today.
It's been my pleasure.
So you've been listening to Bruce Hoffman from Washington. That's the end of this podcast. If you liked what you heard, provide me some feedback. You can reach me on email, borealisrisk@gmail.com, or on Twitter at BorealisSaves. You can also reach me on LinkedIn or on Facebook. You can subscribe to all the content available, podcasts, Today in Terrorism, Perspectives. Just go to www.borealisthreatandrisk.com, hit the subscribe button, fill in your information, and you'll get all the information you want free to your email inbox on a daily basis. I'll talk to you again soon. Until then, stay safe.